What I'd like to do is to shift the attention of the auditorium to broader context of the pathogens and animals. Human, for me as for zoologist, is just another species of animal, and ecosystem it creates.
I'm sorry. There is some problem with your microphone, I guess, because we can hear you, but not in the best way. Maybe you can check it somehow.
Check it somehow. Let's try this. Can you hear me now? Is it better?
It's better, actually.
Okay. So, shift attention from a human and human anthropocentric approach to pathogens and diseases and microorganisms of interest to a broader context of ecosystems. I will try another microphone. Just a second, just one technical moment.
It's okay.
Audio settings. Anyway. This must be better. I switched to another microphone.
Yes, it's better. Thank you.
Even better. Okay. And being a zoologist, I have the main object of my research, reptiles and amphibians, not very popular, vertebrated animals. And gradually I drifted from, so that just happened, from normal population biology and genetics and phylogenetics, and dragged into pathogens of these fascinating objects, pathogens of snakes and frogs. In recent years, there is highly promoted concept in terms of treating pathogens, not only human, not only wild animals, but both human, domestic and wild animals, and this concept called One Health Approach. I don't know if you have heard about it. There is a broad definition and many materials about One Health. You can just type in a Google and find a lot of description, including those official descriptions given by World Health Organization. And I propose you to read this definition by WHO. One Health is an approach to designing and implementing programs, policies, legislations, and research in which multiple sectors communicate and work together to achieve better public health outcomes. I think nobody can understand this definition, and nobody can understand what it is about from this definition. It's too broad and unspecific. It's something for better health. This is obvious, but the background concept is not so easy to grasp. And other sources, they give it as a collaborative efforts of multiple disciplines working locally, nationally, and globally to attain optimal health for people, animals, and our environment. And it's much better because it gives you the breadth of a goal. So human health, domestic animal health and food security, and wild animal health are not treated now separately. And being zoologist, I'm still feel involved in human health issues and do not restrain myself from going not directly, but indirectly into medical problems. And picture is probably the best representation of a One Health, you see three circles indicating human society, wild animals, and domestic animals, and overlapping zones are pathogens and diseases which are shared by between these three groups. Obviously, there are those who are shared between wild and domestic animals, domestic animals and a human, wild animals and a human, and all these groups together. And that's why we need One Health to cope with the threats from the pathogens. We need to understand its circulation, ecology, transmission, and go to the higher level of generalization than in any of a separate disciplines, not only in zoological terms, not only in agriculture, not only in a human health, public health area. The areas of work in which One Health approach is particularly relevant: food safety, control of zoonoses, and combating antibiotic resistance. Basically, every important issue of a current public health is covered here. As for me, I would like to add some ecological approach to study of infectious disease. As I said, many pathogens are shared between human, wild, and domestic animals. Moreover, you need to think about the system as about ecological system. Ecosystem, and more healthy ecosystem means more resilient, without outbreaks, without devastating epidemics or episodes, and without novel pathogens which takes a toll from different objects, from human, from domestic animals, or from wild animals. And you need to keep in mind everything, even climate change, because climate change and habitat loss, they also contribute to increased risks of outbreaks and less resilient global ecosystem in terms of diseases. So altogether, it reminds me Chinese circus and spinning plates. So you keep in mind everything, you are trying not to leave your attention aside from the important issues which are interact with each other, and at the end, if you are good enough, you can hold all these plates in the air, but not always. Nothing new in this world, and my teaching of parasitology to students in Kharkiv University makes me learn in details. Teaching makes you learn better in details ecology and of many pathogens. So, for example, on this picture there are two different types of transmission, sylvatic and domestic cycle of transmission of Trypanosoma cruzi, important pathogen in South America. And you can see there is a sylvatic cycle where wild animals are the reservoir hosts, triatomin bugs or kissing bugs vectors, and just randomly coming to the human houses which are bordering to the forest, to the wild habitat, they bring occasional cases of illness, Trypanosoma cruzi, to a human. And then if you consider that the number of settlements in a forest, in the rural zones of South America increase, and people not only live in these villages on the place of a former forested areas, They also bring their domestic animals, and domestic animals also susceptible to Trypanosoma cruzi infection. You have at the end domestic cycle when triatomin bugs are hiding in a human dwellings, biting infected cats and dogs and other domestic animals, and then transmit disease to a human in a regular way, not occasionally. So this is how everything interacts in the terms of altered ecosystem of a parasite. And the same was studied more for more than 100 years, including in Odessa. Plague is a serious disease. One of the most devastating outbreaks had happened in the 14th century. And since that, we had at least two epidemics of a global scale. So a study of ecology of this bacteria, Yersinia pestis, make us understand that it normally circulates in a natural foci, and even if we will stop transmission between human, from human to human via droplets, direct contact, or fleas, even if we eradicate Yersinia from our domestic animals and get rid of the fleas in a domestic life cycle of this pathogen, it will remain in these folds in wild animals and will cause outbreaks from time to time because of random contacts with a human or human domestic animals, livestock or pets. Moreover, even surveillance, which is important part of One Health approach, will not give you relief, because the pathogen can survive in the soil and be transmitted through the soil. So if you won't find any cases in this particular year, it doesn't mean that the disease is gone, and it may emerge year after or years after, decades after. And knowing of this ecology is very important to stop the transmission of disease. And this is nothing new. One Health doesn't provide you any new approach comparing to the well-studied pathogens. But the new in this situation are new diseases, and such circumstances as globalization of a human travel, human trade. Since the 60s, with the routes of airplanes which connected and made a fast connection between continents, not only between countries, humankind became global civilization, and actually every disease, as we now see, spread across the globe with an enormous speed. Last example, of course, it's coronavirus. I think I shouldn't tell much about it. You know about it from the last 2 years pretty well, almost 3 years pretty well. Originated from a wild animals or transmitted through the some kind of animal in a human environment, maybe through the pangolins, or maybe other creatures who are sold in China in big numbers because of a high consumption as a food, as a traditional medicine. Another aspect of globalization, pet trade and trade of animals for food in China gets enormous scale, and pangolins are probably the most traded wild animals in the world. Millions of them are carried frozen or alive in the cages from tropical Asia or Africa to China, and there is no surprise that something may happen on this stage. So new diseases are emerging and spreading in a speed which was not seen before. So still, ecology of a pathogen important, ecology of transmission is important, but there are no new circumstances. I hope you get it. And another thing which is different from the past in a current situation, if we will get rid of anthropocentric approach, we will see that before human, we have most of the animals, most of the mammals specifically, being wild animals, and human and domestic animals get only a fraction of this diversity. Now, 60% of all mammals on Earth are livestock, cows, goats, sheep, animals which we eat or milk. And then 36% are humans and only 4% are wild animals. So it causes alteration in an ecosystem, in a global ecosystem. This changes impossible to neglect. And this global population of livestock is quite uniform. It's get out of the natural selection, they can be easily susceptible to a new pathogen, which can spread really with a lightning speed across the globe, and the same with the human. And animals, and wild animals in this case, are suffering from global pressure, from a habitat alteration, and also from a diseases, which goes not only from wild animals to a domestic, to a human, but backwards too. And still we are often anthropocentric, but if you will look on a biodiversity on the planet, we will see that most of the species are invertebrates, and most of the invertebrates are unknown for us, and also considerable part of diversity of fishes and amphibians are not yet described. We are living on unknown Earth. And talking about amphibians, they can look, you know, not so important, but actually they sustain in many ecosystems. They are important part of the food networks. They are important for science, for medicine, for pest control. They are indicators of a healthy environment. Sometimes in some traditions, they are food. Of course, they are in our cultures. And 40% of amphibians globally are now endangered. So this is the most endangered group of vertebrated animals. And like in a human, globalization and global trade, global pet and pet trade and selling frogs for food in Asia, in Africa for laboratory diagnostics worldwide, makes them susceptible to panzoonotic, and recently, starting approximately in 1970s, one pathogen, Batrachohydrium batilis, emerged somewhere, new strain of it emerged somewhere in South Asia or Africa, and then transported with a pet trade to South America and caused a global crisis of biodiversity of amphibians there. No surprise, human-mediated disease spreading in amphibians. And here you can see dead frogs, victims of chytridiomycosis caused by Batrachohydrium dendrobatilis. And the number of species which had significant decline number since habitat alteration. I'm sorry, can you switch your microphone? You can hear a noise.
I'm sorry, Maria, can you turn off your mic?
Probably you can switch off your microphone.
Dear participants, some of you have your microphones on. Please turn them off for the lecture. Thank you.
Can be done manually from host.
A host can do it.
Okay, let me check it out.
And just hard to concentrate if you hear something always.
I think everything's okay. Please continue. I'm sorry. Okay.
Yeah, thank you. So they are suffering from habitat loss, and at the same time, you on top of that, you have a new disease. Of course, the effect of this disease can be just devastating in small range animals with a small population size and small potential to evolve resistance. The panzoonotic of heterotrichomycosis caused literally dying out of species, many tens of species in Central and South America, in the areas where heterotrichomycosis was not present before. And if we will talk about Ukraine is also part of the global world, and probably heterotrichomycosis had happened in our amphibians too, but we have no data until recently, virtually no data. We are like pretending that nothing is happening in here. And the question is if it already was here and local amphibians developed resistance, or maybe communities of local amphibians have changed since the advent of heterotrichomycosis, or it's still coming to us and we will see something bad in years to come. There was a small project with Jagiellonian University and with the help of colleagues from Ukrainian Herpetological Society, we covered more or less the whole territory of Ukraine, collected samples, and we got few detections only in the northwestern Ukraine. Two or three populations where heterotrichomycosis is present. Ongoing project. So this is one direction of my research. Another good example of a global consequences of a global trade and global transportation and global transmission, human mediated transmission of diseases, white nose syndrome in bats. So on the left side and on the right side, you have the map of United States and Canada. This is an eastern coast. And what you see here is the number of individuals in hibernation sites in the caves in 2007 and in 2019. Some species just almost went extinct after new disease emerged in this continent. This disease, white nose syndrome, affects bats in hibernation sites. It's a fungus, white nose syndrome, because fungus start to grow from a nose and then cover the body of a bat and makes it sleep bad in the winter time. And in winter time, bats are falling into a very deep sleeping stage of a torpor. And in this stage, in this condition of the body, they do not spend much energy and can stay inactive in the caves until next spring. And if they are infected, they probably became itchy and start to move constantly and lose their weight very fast and die out in big numbers. What means big numbers? Like 90% of a population in 10 years, millions of bats, and this is a shockwave effect, has a shockwave effect on the entire ecosystem. Bats are consuming a lot of insects, and insects are pests, and insects are also vectors of many diseases. So you will see probably in the worst case scenario, collapse of entire ecosystem and the consequences far on the food chain and consequences on ecological level, which we may not like. So some species almost extinct, and the fungus causing it is a pseudo-gymnoascus destructans, originate from Eurasia and brought to caves of Northern America, probably by speleologists or herpetologists. So people who studied caves and cave animals may bring something very bad to these caves and animals living in them. Of course, not without bad intentions. It just happened because of they neglect this possibility. Being on a high alert with the fungal infections in the United States, local scientists, local zoologists monitor population for new diseases. And again, another group was affected, snakes, snake fungal disease, and the species which caused it, Ophidiomyces ophidiicola, first caused skin lesions in the snakes, aquatic semi-aquatic snakes, and then in the hibernation, when the immune system is low, it spread across the body, may affect internal organs, also debilitate the animal and make it not survive until next spring. And you see interesting maps here. So first detected in two states, and then in few years found in four or five states, then almost entire United States of America is covered by the detection of Ophidiomyces ophidiicola, but we still don't know how bad is it, and definitely some populations are highly affected, but others are okay. And what people are doing, they are checking for the presence of this Ophidiomyces ophidiicola in historical soil samples, and they found it 50 years ago, so probably either climate change or other factors are contributing to spreading this disease in the natural populations, or maybe this is a new strain of old pathogen to which animals are not adapted yet, or in general it's an effect of our too high attention to the normally circulating disease in wild animals. We are also involved in this study, but not in the United States. In Europe, only few records of Ophidiomyces ophidiicola in wild-caught snakes were registered in Great Britain. In Great Britain, just because people in Great Britain start to look at snakes and pathogens, fungal pathogens on them, and in Czech Republic. And then we did the same in Ukraine, and we're doing this now in a collaboration with Virginia Tech University. Currently analyzed several hundreds of snakes and found only in a few individuals of the natrix ring snake. It's interesting to dig into the ecology of pathogen. Why only in aquatic snakes? Sometimes natrix and our others, vipers are living together side by side and using the same hibernation site or basking site, so lay on top of each other. But one species is affected, another not affected. We have hypothesis that optimal conditions for this fungus is a temperature 28 degrees and pH 9, which is not very common in nature, but pretty common if you have dirty, warm waste water. And natrix semi-aquatic snakes, it often goes into this water, bathing in this water, searching for food, for frogs, and probably highly exposed to the conditions which are favorable to the pathogen to grow on a surface of a skin. And then interesting to know how long the pathogen can survive in the soil. There is indication that it can live in the soil for a certain time, but again, in which patch of a soil it will survive, and where on the sun, for example, in a dry soil it will die, and where it will have higher chances to be transmitted to another non-aquatic species. So perhaps there are conditions when it can spread between species to another species of snakes, local snakes, including those which are already endangered because of habitat loss and shrinked range. Another direction of future studies is to check virulence of European and American, Northern American strains of Idiomycetes ofidiicola, and we are working towards isolating local variants of this fungus. While working on it, we found another worrisome fact that insect pathogens can jump over the species border and then cause some skin lesions in reptiles too. So what is in common between reptiles and insects? That they are both have an external skin layer which is not alive. It's a kind of cuticula from chitin in insects and scales from keratin in snakes. And Bovaria bassiana is an occasional pathogen of reptiles, and nothing in biology remains the same. There is an evolution process, and probably we could see some processes of adaptation to a new host in this species, and must continue surveillance of wild animals, fungal diseases. So all these three species which I mentioned now are fungi. And human is next victim of a fungal outbreak. And 300 of fungi are seriously considered as an emerging diseases, especially in immunocompromised patients, including Aspergillus, Candidus, different species, and so on. So being able to infect new host from amphibians or reptiles, fungi, they have a potential to spread to a human or to domestic animals too. And last not least, I'd like to talk about a separate project I'm doing with in a collaboration with next generation facilities in Kyiv. We are studying a diversity of microorganisms in a snake's gut. So snakes are quite unique in terms of feeding. They are swollen, they prey completely with intestines, with everything on top of surface of a victim. Snakes are eating randomly, but acquiring a lot of protein-rich food in one feeding. They have also long hibernation at low temperatures. So from point of view of circulation of microorganisms, including potentially pathogenic ones, they can serve both as a reservoir for many bacteria, and probably they could be also sanitizers eating. And if conditions inside the snakes are not favorable for pathogen, it will be digested and not be transmitted further. Two types of approach we did. First is a traditional bacteriological study with a isolation of cultures. In one season, from 57 samples, gave us 146 isolates of many quite common species of bacteria, including potentially dangers like Salmonella species. Salmonella likes gut of vipers very much because, again, snakes are eating only meat, only protein-rich food. So it's a good conditions inside the snake for such a microorganism. It's somehow difficult to get to handle both snake, I'm sorry for the quality of the picture, maybe it's for a better, handle venomous snakes and at the same time handle a sterile swab and take a cloacal swab from a snake in the wild. You need first to find snake, catch it carefully and hold it carefully. And next year, after traditional approach, we switched to a next generation metabarcoding approach and took only eight samples and checked from hypothesis that snakes after hibernation and after first feeding will have different gut microbiome. We measured, alpha and beta diversity using pipeline, bioinformatic pipeline. I see that I'm a little bit out of time. Okay, and in a few weeks and from eight samples, we received much bigger number of bacterial species, including those who are not easily isolated from in a culture. And in spite, we have the same core species of Salmonella, Enterococcus, Yersinia, Serratia, Obisum bacteria, diversity of microorganisms studied and revealed by next generation metabarcoding approach was much higher with a less effort and but probably more expenses for consumables. So, and results from our metabarcoding looks like that. So from one sample, you can see up to 50 species of bacteria identified up to the genus or species level. In bioinformatic aspect, it looks like reads of individual organisms, and from 2 to 139,000 of reads. Those who were low read number failed to reveal the all diversity of microorganisms in a sample. But there is some kind of a threshold which allows you to grasp the diversity of microorganisms. Sampling is important, and obtaining a good DNA is important for describing diversity of microorganisms in details. There is a correlation between number of reads and number of species found, so it's obvious that sampling is important. I'm pointed on this again. And there is no correlation between number of species of bacteria in cloacal swabs of the snakes and date of collection. So it sounds like snakes emerge from hibernation after half a year at the temperature about zero and without any intake of food. They emerge immediately with the high diversity of microorganisms in their gut. Must be a challenge for the immune system to contain this microorganism, not damage the snake itself. And the snakes in this case looks like reservoir for many microorganisms. They support in the gut and hold until the next warm season. Every snake gut is different. So when we do PCA analysis, we see that the most of the samples are equally distant from each other. It would be interesting to play with the same snakes and check how the microbiome changing during the season or between seasons. We have a monitoring program of a population and hopefully could do that next seasons. And another representation of a uniqueness of every snake's microbiome is with Venn diagrams. And how to say this, these rays are different samples. So you can see on the left side, number of shared and number of unique species, or on the right side, number of shared and number of unique genera of bacteria in each sample. And what is the most prominent in these diagrams is that every snake has many species of bacteria unique to only this snake, and only two species are common in all samples. And I will skip this. So potentially in a snake gut, there are many potential pathogenic species. Diversity of them do not decrease after long fasting and hibernation. There is high degree of individuality in microbiome composition, and we also need to check another hypothesis. The population we studied is in a nearby big city, and sewage water running directly into a forest, into a habitat, and probably some of these pathogens will not be found in a wild population without human impact on an ecosystem. So why we should care about wild animals? Why we are doing this all this strange project in with pathogens of nobody needs for frogs and snakes? First, because to care about somebody is ethical, it's good. The second, I already mentioned that these animals are important parts of ecosystems. And the third, that the collapse of ecosystem may cause the problem for entire global ecosystem and for human population too. So next time going to a field, every time going to a field now and doing a field work with the wild animals, I now start to be concerned about my not only my safety, but the impact I can bring to a local population. So tools must be sterilized. Researcher also must care about handling, especially obviously ill animals. And what I took like message, take home message for me from my own studies is I shouldn't never ever do what I have done in my students' years. Never eat the frogs raw and wash hands upon wash tools after field work. I would like to acknowledge all these people. So these are ongoing projects with our herpetological society from left to right, from top to bottom. Jagiellonian University, Maciek Pabijan, my good friend and colleagues from genetic lab in Kyiv, who did the next generation sequencing, Maxim Kremenskoy, my PhD student, Oleksandra Klinova, who is doing his PhD on fungal pathogens of reptiles, student Mikhailo Ryuk, who is now somewhere displaced as like me, Alexei Solodyankin, Institute of Experimental Veterinary, Kharkiv, Karazin, Kharkiv University student, PhD student, frog lover, Nicholas Drogvalenko, and our US collaborators, Gaelle Blanvillan and Joseph Hoyt, who are studying fungal pathogens of animals in Virginia Tech University. And I'm also now in a displaced person from Kharkiv. I'm in Lviv in Explogen LCC lab, and I would like to acknowledge them for providing me a place to work and to hold this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. It was very interesting. I don't know about other participants, but for me, it was quite new and unique material. So it was really great. Dear participants, do you have any questions after this wonderful lecture? Maybe you can write something in the chat. Well, while our participants are thinking, I have a little question for you. How do you explain that the snakes that you studied have these unique bacteria species? Well, you pointed that they have unique species. And how do you explain it? Why they're so, well, what's the explanation?
I think the explanation could be the diet. So the number of different objects they consume, mm-hmm. They belong to different groups of animals. So mm-hmm. It's like in a human. In a human gut microbiome, it was also shown that our microbiome depends on what we are eating. And a snake, when it takes one mouse or frog or lizard, this eats microbiome inside, and the mass of a prey is a huge, and the amount of bacteria it consumes with the prey is also huge. And that's why I think they can be, you know, very much deviated from each other. It depends from the last prey. Would be interesting to do it in experimental conditions and feed them the same species of a mice, or to check the microbiome of a mice before feeding and to check what survived in a snake and stayed in a snake. I think this is a way to think about the diversity and uniqueness of diversity of microbiome snakes.
Okay, thank you. I got your idea, yes. And one more little question about epidemiologists. I understood that people can transmit infections, but is there any data? Can people infect animals, especially wild animals? Have you met such data?
What do you mean? In most of the cases, these diseases are transmitted, human-mediated transmission via trade. So Batrachohydrium dendrobatidis came to Northern America, Central America, with a pet trade, with a African clawed frogs, Xenopus laevis, mm-hmm. which can be ill with Batrachohydrium dendrobatidis, but this disease is not deadly for this frog. It can stay alive for a long time and then being transported from one continent to another and sold there and then released in the nature by people who are doing bad things always. You see how many red air turtles are in our ponds in Ukraine. So they do that in a regular way. Or wasted water may carry it in a natural water bodies and later spread in local species. I think this is the most probable way of a transmission, human-mediated transmission.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And we also have questions on the chat. Well, I can see from Olga Mikhailovna Marchuk. Can you see the question?
Yeah. What do you think about this problem? Can be anthropogenic influence on ecology? Thank you. Yeah, this is, you know, as far as I can understand the question. Yes, we are living in a different type of ecosystem now, where you cannot neglect the human global influence on a distribution of both invasive species and pathogens for them, for wild and domestic species. Why there is no herbivorous snakes in the world, in your opinion? Very simple answer. To digest animal food, you need to have a long intestine. And snake is, you know, linear. There is no folds of intestine inside the snake. It's just a hollow tube from mouth to cloaca. And you have a limited time in the intestine. You cannot efficiently digest lots of vegetarian food in such a type of system. Are there any estimates of the possible adaptation of bats or frogs population to these new pathogens? Do they have any information on their genetic diversity? Is there any chance of population natural recovery? I believe that they will recover if human will not introduce new species of pathogens in few years. So all the processes in biology are slow and fast. You can define a biological system as a slow fast system, and slow in this case is evolution. So we are alive, it means that we and these bats and frogs are still alive, they didn't die out. It means they are capable to evolve resistance to many diseases in the evolutionary past. But if you will, you know, try to introduce new diseases to them in a frequency which is not natural, you will probably lose most of the diversity of these species, and only few will remain, and the ecosystem will be not such resilient as with a bigger number of species. Evolution is slow. Spreading of a pathogens with the help of a human is high. It is too high to secure the future of many species on Earth. Thank you very much. So there are no more questions in the